A lot of people, when they play the game, they look at the attack cards and see the letters representing the strength, from D being the worst to the star being the best, and then they construct a deck. I have some news for you. The letters isn't all that counts. It gives a good feel for the strength of the card, but that's about it. Let me give you an example. Using a combo with Total Eclipse, Starseeker and Oblivion yields this. Two of those Keyblades are C+, while Oblivion is a B. Now let's try to see what happens if we use two C Keyblades and a D+. It is clear that even though the latter combo has weaker cards when looking at the attack stat in the deck building menu, they deal more damage. A skeptic might say that it's the element of the Keyblade that plays a trick on us. This is not true. The Defender Heartless I was fighting doesn't have any resistances whatsoever. Then if we can't trust what the game tells us a card's strength is, then how do you choose which cards to use? I'll tell you. Open up your menu and go down to the journal. In there, choose Card Index, Attack Cards, and then the Keyblade you're interested in. Here you can see some of the stats that weren't visible from the deck building menu. We'll go through them all in detail, starting with the first three. I want to give a little heads up though, that every number I mention has been obtained empirically. But without further ado, let's get into it. The first three attacks are called Strike, Thrust and Combo Finisher. These three correspond to the attacks in Sora's combos. The first attack is called the Strike, the second is the Thrust and the final attack is the Finisher. This also applies if Sora does an aerial combo. The Kingdom Key has the same strength in all three attacks, but most other Keyblades vary from one attack to another. An example is the Oblivion Keyblade that has an A in Strike and Thrust, but a meager D in Finisher, which means it's pretty great used in the first two attacks, but it's pure trash as a finisher. The letter shown under Strength in the deck building menu is just the average of these three, so sometimes it gives a false impression of the Keyblade's strength, just like with the Oblivion Keyblade. We know the letter represents the strength of the Keyblade, but how strong exactly is a D compared to a B? This can be pretty important if you want to use your CP wisely, but the game doesn't tell us anything. If we define the lowest tier, which is D, to have a power of 1, then the strength is increased by 1 every time the tier is increased. This means that a D+ is equal to using 2 Ds, and a C is equal to using D 3 times, and so on and so forth. It's a little weird that we don't have an A+, but that they made a star instead. For the combo finisher, you actually can't trust what it says the tier is, as the finisher is always upgraded to the tier above it, so if you use the B for the finisher, you would actually get a B+. If you used S that has a strength of 8, then you would actually be using a 9. There are two special attack cards that doesn't abide by the normal rules of dealing damage that I just mentioned, and those are 2 Become 1 and 1 Winged Angel. The 2 Become 1 Keyblade upgrades the finisher tier by 1 just as all the other Keyblades, but the first attack, the Strike, gets downgraded to a tier below what it is. This is very odd. It was originally Roxas Keyblade, so maybe it's a nod to Sheehan absorbing Roxas' power. The One Winged Angel Keyblade also upgrades the finisher's tier, but it does it in a more extreme way. The finisher gets upgraded 4 tiers, which means the finisher's damage reaches a whopping 12. This Keyblade is pretty good to begin with, but counting the finisher, no other Keyblade comes close to the same damage in a single hit. To get a good idea of how much choosing the right card for Strike, Thrust and Finisher means, I'll show these two little clips. The first is a completely hopeless setup, and that should be clear from the damage output. The second round uses the same cards, but with an optimized setup. In both rounds I used two combos. The difference in damage is massive. What if we were just to use one Keyblade? Which one would be best? The answer isn't that surprising, but I've made a list nonetheless. Here can be seen an ordered list of the strongest combo with the Keyblade. The number is of course how much damage the combo does. The next stat pertains to the elemental system, which is pretty easy to understand. For every element, an enemy is either weak, strong or indifferent towards it. If an enemy is weak towards an element, then your damage is scaled by 1.5. If they're strong, your damage is halved, and if the enemy is indifferent, you deal normal damage. One important thing to note is that the neutral type some Keyblades have is great towards normal enemies, as all of them are indifferent, but unfortunately almost all bosses are strong towards it. Before we jump into the break recovery part, let me just kill a myth. A card number has no influence on damage at all, whether it be in combos or slides. The number is only relevant when looking towards card breaks. The next stat is break recovery, that is, how fast you can do something after you've gotten your card broken. I don't think this stat is particularly important, but it's good to be aware of it if you're on the fence about two equally good Keyblades. Most of the time though, we try to avoid getting our cards broken, so this is more like a fail-safe. This time the plus tiers haven't been included, and there's actually no D in break recovery anywhere. The differences between the tiers aren't that great, but they are noticeable. The break recovery times can be seen here. The recovery gets a sixth of a second less every time. There isn't much else to say about this, it's pretty straightforward, so let's get to the required CP stat. The final stat is the required CP. If you hadn't realized it yet, CP stands for card points, and as you should be aware, it is the limiting factor when building a deck. This stat tells us how much the card will cost to get in the deck. The cost of a card is pretty easy to calculate. The CP cost of a number 1 star card is 10. Every time you decrease the tier, the number 1 card costs 5 more. For a star card, when the number increases, you have to add the increase to the CP. The 0 cards count as 10s. Using the described method means a number 7 star card costs 16. 10 for the 1 card and then additionally 6 for the increase to 7. The same increase is true for A cards, but for the rest of the tiers, there's a slight change. For tiers B and C, you have to double the increase, and for D, you need to triple it. If you have a premium card, then the cost of that card is equivalent to that of a 1 card in the same CP tier. With the data from before of which Keyblade is the strongest, let's now see which Keyblades can deal the most damage in a combo per CP spent for the cards. I'm going to use the CP cost of 1 card in these calculations, and I've multiplied the result by 100 to avoid too many zeros. I was actually surprised to see how well cards like Ultimate Weapon and Oathkeeper held up. I thought they would be very inefficient, but that isn't the case. To get a little clearer picture, we're going to calculate with the zero cost also. Again, I've multiplied the result by 100. The list is super jumbled when comparing it to the strength list, and there isn't too much of a difference from the best to the worst. Most of the time, the lists I just shown aren't that useful, as the best results are obtained by mixing and matching cards. A more relevant list would be the strength per CP in the position where the card does the most damage. This list is probably a good reference point if you're ever to construct a deck, but doesn't quite remember which cards are strongest in which positions. Now we've reached the end of the video, so I just want to thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.